Hey, it's Michael's Breakfast, and I'm going to do a vlog for you, and maybe you'll glean a thing or two. Morning, everyone. Coffee. It is Don Cafe, instant Ecuadorian coffee, which is better than our brewed coffee up here. So anyway, why did I sing the Fat Albert song? And I had to rehearse that a lot because the words were stuck in my head, you know, like, hey, it's Fat Albert. And so that was stuck in my head and I'm trying to change the words. And that's what I want to talk about today. The influence of movies. I went through a whole bunch of my movie lists and I was thinking about the movies that we've had in our modern history. Like we've had I'm talking about my lifetime, right? I can't talk about movies that were made in the 1930s or stuff like that, but stuff that influenced my life, like we're talking, I'll just go real quick here, real quick. You know, 3 Days of the Condor, New Centurions, Rollerball, Soylent Green, Dr. Strangelove, Failsafe, THX-1138, The Package, and we could go on, 12 Monkeys and all kinds of other movies and stuff like that, but the main thing I if you'll think, like the Fat Albert thing, like, that's what I watched as a kid, right? Scooby-Doo, Bugs Bunny, Fat Albert, the Cosby Kids, and all that stuff. So it made me the person I am today with the way I look at the world today. I was influenced by television. I mean, we can think about the history of television and movies, and we can, like, when we look at a James Bond movie in the old days, you look at James Bond movies, basically were tourist shows. You look at, Goldfinger. Well, that shows you Kentucky and it shows you Europe. You Only Live Twice, Japan, beautiful country. You want to go to Japan. From Russia with Love, you get, I believe you're in Turkey and Hungary and all those places. So you look at the way movies have been going on and you look back and you say, okay, it can guide our psyche. It can guide my psyche. It can make me think like I'm Star Trek, Star Wars, Pollyanna type guy. So this is what I think of when I think of movies. And when I look at our modern day and how the craziness that's been going on with things, I look at these movies like 3 Days of the Condor, New Centurions, Rollerball, Soylent Green, Dr. Strangelove, Failsafe. And I also want to talk about Deep Impact and Armageddon. Those two movies, not that they influence, but when I look at Failsafe and I look at Dr. Strangelove and I look at Deep Impact and I look at Armageddon, Failsafe and Dr. Strangelove were released in the same year. The movie is almost, the two movies are identical in their nuclear discussion or nuclear theme or whatever, what have you. And the thing with Deep Impact is the same thing. The theme is more, it's a disaster movie for the space stuff. Rock's going to come and kill us all type scenario. But you look at the difference in the two movies. Failsafe was a very somber, not fun, happy, ha ha ha, nuclear war is going to kill us all. Dr. Strangelove was. Armageddon was more of a in your face, Bruce Willis, shoot him up, blow up asteroids. And in my opinion, and this is just the way I feel, Deep Impact was let's let our feels deal with it, And you can look at those two movies. They're completely different. Failsafe, Dr. Strangelove, Deep Impact, and Armageddon are different. But there again. So I just wanted to go through a couple of the movies that I was thinking that actually made that for me. And now we talk about my personal opinion, right? This is only for me. Like when I think about the person that I am and the person that I've become, the tapestry of my existence, if I can use that term, movies influenced my life. I mean, let's be real. I was in the gym in the 1980s when Terminator came out, okay? And I can promise you, after seeing Arnold Schwarzenegger in the size he was, and I was like, because I had watched Pumping Iron and everything, and then, but that was earlier, and then I see this, and I'm like, wow, he motivated me to be, more, yeah, okay. I'm not Arnold Schwarzenegger, but like that kind of movie it influenced in that aspect. Not to say that I wanted to be a Terminator, but to say that influenced me in my life. And it got me thinking about things. So when I think about these old movies, and I think about, like, and I just wanted to talk about a couple of the older ones. And I always mention them when I do videos. I say, hey, man, you should watch 3 Days of the Condor, or you should watch this, you should watch Rollerball, and blah, blah, blah. Well, there's a reason I say it, because for me, I took a message from it. I look at the movie, and yes, like, you know, I watch a lot of movies, and yes, they are entertaining, but I like to think that there's a message in it of some sort. Sometimes the movies are just movies. Like Armageddon, in my opinion, doesn't have a message to tell me. It's just flashing your pen, you know, pop, 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 shooting, you know, da, 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 all crazy stuff. There's no real message. When I look at other movies like The New Centurions or 3 Days, Rollerball, where's the other one? The Package as well. That's another one. Soylent Green, stuff like that. But anyway, let's just talk about The New Centurions first. New Centurions, 1972. It's a cop movie. I believe that the book Joseph Wamba was the he had a lot of good cop books back then. Anyway, Joseph Wamba, if I'm not mistaken, and New Centurions. But what I notice about the New Centurions when I'm trying to make correlations and possible comparisons to today is that Empire of old, they had their centurions. New Empire, we've got our new centurions. And if you look at the movie and you watch what the cops are doing, and we're talking cops of old, okay? I'm not talking about today's cops who are more militaristic. The cops of old, the new centurions, are almost like the daycare workers of the day. Like if you look at the characters in the new centurions, George C. Scott, Stacy Keach, Rosalind Cash, and Eric Estrada from Chips. Okay, that's funny, actually, Chips. But you look at you watch the movie and you see how the cops are interacting with the public. You see their attitudes, how they do policing and stuff like that. So I look at the public and the cops and the way they are today, and it's not much different than history of old. The cops are still doing what the centurions did of old. It's almost like daycare. I don't need a cop to tell me that, you know, to go into a store with a gun and this or that is wrong, or to grab some old lady's purse is wrong. I don't need a cop to tell me that. But for some reason, we do. So we have to have babysitters and daycare workers in amongst the public to take care of us. Never seen any of them.
They're not bad. Like, okay, new centurions. Some of them are real trudges, like Rollerball, real trudge.
You can go into the Wikipedia if you want and check on what the write-ups are. And you can even loosely go to IMDb. But, you know, some of the reviews, and you look at some of the stuff that's written by the mainstream reviewers, you know, it's like, wow, did you even watch the movie? You know, like when I look at Highlander and the reviews that they did at the time, and I'm like, wow, did you guys even watch the movie? The cinematography in that movie was amazing. But all you did was you didn't like it because it was about, like, immortal? Anyway, you know, it's like, okay, did you even watch the movie, or did you just get paid off to write a bad review? So these are the things. So you have to go through, and like I said, with all of these movies, a grain of salt as well. Like these are impressions that I get, that I've watched these movies, and these are the feelings that I get. So when I watched The New Centurions, and I saw it, and I watched the movie, and I'm watching, I'm like, well, this hasn't changed. This is just basically showing us that they're going to have to be daycare and pablum spoon feeders for us in our modern future. So the new centurions for me is we have the new centurions. We have the new people walking around the beat and making sure that the slaves are all in line. And that's basically what it is when I look at how we are and how that is. And it seems pretty obvious to me. There seems to be no real questions about how we're going about business. And I can just harken back to a Star Trek episode I think the episode is called Bread and Circuses, when the Enterprise goes back and they find out another ship had gone way before the Prime Directive or whatever, and it crashed and it landed on this planet that was not unlike Earth, and they had their Romans and they had their modern day gladiatorial games, so like basically Rome today, so nothing had changed. And then you get Spock, he's like, wow, yeah, it's pretty cool, man. You've got like modern day, you know, slaves are taken care of, they got health care and da-da-da. And he's going through all the lists, and then the doctor just loses his shit. McCoy just loses his shit, and he goes, dude, but that's what's happening today.
like people hate to say when I say stuff like that. I said, yeah, yeah, you know, we're pretty good as slaves. You know, we've got our daycare. I can go on, I can get my broken arm fixed and stuff like that. But if, you know, I don't want to sound so pessimistic, but if you look at it, it's like nothing really much has changed. And Spock was right. You know, why, you know, it's not, you know, and he even said it, he says, I don't agree with it, but it works, you know, like that's the thing. You know, we can all sit here and say, well, yeah, it's a bad idea, but it works. You know, that's the thing. So in the New Centurions, I look today in the parallels, you look at the episode Bread and Circuses. It's a good episode of Star Trek, the original with Jim and all the rest of them. But I encourage you to just, you know, take an hour, 2 hours. These movies aren't long. You can just log it and say, yeah, I watched it. It was shit. Or yeah, it wasn't bad. Or yeah, I can see where he's going. And no, he's whacked. I don't agree with anything he said. You know, it's all up to you. It's all opinion. And these are all my own feels about how I interpret these movies. But we can know. I mean, you know, while mom was home making the cake and it that's soap operas, you know, sponsored by, you know, like sand through the hourglass. So goes my cup of coffee that's been sponsored by, you know, whomever. So that's television. That's what it was designed for, just to spoon feed us, to feed us stuff. You can learn from it, but I, you know, like I hope anyway. I'm just going to go like by year too, and I'll just segue, go right into Three Days of the Condor. Now that one, to me, there's no question that it's an absolutely beautiful movie. Yes, it's very slow and trudging like all the rest of the movies in the 70s, because, you know, it's not that, it's all talking and yapping and stuff. Although 3 Days has some good moments in it. It has some, you know, the beginning's pretty exciting, and then it just kind of slows, but then it picks up. It's one of those. But anyway, yeah, if you really wanted an idea of like how things are going in our backwards deals and stuff like that, I have a good watch of this movie, 3 Days of the Condor, with Robert Redford. 1975, Robert Redford, Faye Dunaway, Cliff Robertson, Max von Sydow, and John Houseman. A good cast. I mean, you know, this is a CIA conspiracy movie. But the thing about it is that when you look at the Turner character, and he's just a civvy, you know, he's just a guy who reads book. He's a librarian, but he works for the CIA. And then, you know, these guys are just book readers. And then all of a sudden, you know, something goes wrong, and his life is turned into an absolute shit show. And it's the CIA coming after him because he realizes that, wow, all of a sudden he realizes that, yeah, there's a bunch of nefarious characters inside the nefarious characters. So that's what it is. And then you look back today with all our intelligence and our alphabet agencies and people, you know, back doors and stuff, and one hand not knowing what the other hand's doing, and this guy's shaking hands over here while this guy's shaking hands over here. I encourage you to watch Three Days of the Condor. And I mean, at the end, it's just amazing. The ending is amazing, in my opinion. It just, like, I don't know. For me, it was one of those, you know, and it took a while because, yeah, I've been watching this movie forever and a day. And then all of a sudden, more in the last 20 years, I've been watching, I'm like, oh crap, are you serious? You know, shoot, bang, I should have had a V8, you know? It was that easy for me. But, you know, and I'm not saying that I could be taking a message that isn't even there. You know, so don't, like, you know, this is me. This is me I'm talking about. What a great movie, though. CIA. I mean, the movie itself is just fantastic when you think about the inner workings, and they go back and forth to the World Trade Centers when they're still standing, where the CIA have their offices. So, you know, anyway, just I encourage you to watch that movie. They're not long. You know, these aren't like, you know, 3-4 hour Charlton Heston movies, you know, like the Ten Commandments or anything. These are 2 hour movies, 2 hours of your life wasted. Chalk that up for done, and you can move on. You can shit on me later and say, you waste my 2 hours. And I said, I'll be sorry for that if you didn't like the movie. But just look at it. Look at it, that movie, and then look at today. And just try and make, and these are all I'm doing. I'm just trying to make some parallels and just trying to understand what's going on in our life today. Because these, you know, maybe they were influenced by television. So the sickos and the psychos that are in charge of the world, they go, oh yeah, man, I got that idea from the Human Centipede. You know, like, I'm, you know, like, but these are out there. You know, there are copycat people, copycat killers. So why can't there be copycat psychopaths? You know, oh, that'd be a great idea. You know, you need somebody. I'm glad I have handlers. You know, I got my higher power, Gaia Mother, and I got all my handlers hanging around, my demons and my angels. And they're like, no, that's a bad idea. Give me a swift kick in the ass somehow. And say, no, that's a shit idea. you know, jumping off the roof with a bed sheet ain't gonna work, Michael. You know. Okay, movies. I watched a couple of the, like, I keep rolling through the classics. I'll watch Soylent Green. I'll watch Rollerball. I'll watch The Package. I'll watch them all over and over again because I've tried to watch new movies. And wow, for me today, there's nothing cerebral in them. They're all just like, yeah, shoot, kill, strangle, you know, whatever. There are some, don't get me wrong. I mean, I've watched some, like, I like Guardians of the Galaxy. I thought it was great. But, you know, anyway. So we can talk about Rollerball. I've mentioned this before, and I even see it now. I even see it now where all this, you know, with this nonsense, I don't even want to use the word. We'll just use the word. With the word has been going on. So, and you see the corporations and everything seems to be being consolidated. Things are going to be closed down. You're not going to see this anymore. All of a sudden it'd be like, oh yeah, they got bought up by. Or they got, you know, amalgamated with or whatever, what have you. And I watch Rollerball and I look at the movie itself and I'm trying to understand, like, you know, you read the write-ups and you try and figure out what Norman Jewison was trying to put forth. You know, these guys, they have an idea when they're making these movies. You know, they've got the book or whatever they're going for their basic information. But what I take from Rollerball is the corporate aspect of it. And while Norman Jewison, because I read what he wrote, he was more about, he wanted to put forth the idea about how future violent games were terrible. But that's not what I take away from the movie. I take away more about the dystopia type future and disconnect between the, you know, like you listen to them like, oh, you got your privilege card. You're good, man. You can do whatever you want. You know, you're not a slave. You're Jonathan E, man. And then the corporations run everything and everything is done. And you do, everybody even says, do what you're told. That's the whole thing. If you want to please the corporate masters, do what you're told all the time. And that's what I take away from those movies. Like, I mean, it just seems to be very obvious to me. And I'm not saying that it should be obvious to everybody, but these are things that I take away. A great movie, though. James Caan, John Houseman, John Beck, Moses Gunn, John Beck, Moon Pie. I love Moon Pie in the movie. I mean, you know, it's a pretty good movie. I'm going to, okay, Days of the Condor, I'll give it a hard 7.5. Rollerball, I'll give it a hard 7, 6.5. It gets really slow. So you really got to, that one's a hard one to go through. You might have to watch it a few times or fast through some of the stupid scenes, like when they're shooting the trees, you know, but that's part of the movie as well. But when I look at how they interact with each other and the questions that they're asking seems to be the questions that we're asking today. You know, how did we get to here? What brought us to the here? And then when Moses Gunn and the James Caan character are talking about it, and Gunn's talking about, I remember the NFL and, you know, the world football and then the wars and the corporate wars. And I think that's what we're in right now. I think there's a struggle in the corporate for dominance right now. And it will be Walmart. It will be Costco. It will be Taco Bell. And there will be no little Johnny mom and pop stores because that isn't controllable. That isn't something you can't tell Johnny down the street who's selling his potatoes, you know, what price he has to sell them for, how big they've got to be, da, da, da. So when I look at Rollerball and I look at our modern history, I say, you know, we're in that. We're in the corporate war. You see the amalgamations. You've seen, like, where's Zellers? Where's BOAC? Where's some of these other airlines? You know, I flew some airlines that don't even exist anymore. I'm trying to remember, you know, Ward Air or any of the other ones just get swallowed up and everything else. That's why when I look at these new startup companies like Virgin and stuff, I don't even know what they're getting at. So Rollerball, it's another good one. The new Centurions will tell us, you know, okay, the cops. 3 days will tell us the psychos. And Rollerball will tell us the corporation. And I put this other one in here. Well, I can mention Soylent Green really quickly because Soylent Green, to me, 2022 is when it's supposed to happen. Next year, 2 years from now. And then we've got this talk because we've seen over the last little 10 years or 5 years or so, and I've been looking at a lot of the channels talking about possible solar minimum or a solar minimum. and a shakeup in our ecosystem, you know, growing seasons being shorter, impossible mini ice age, food shortages, and now we've got this absolute asshole pandemic or whatever, plandemic, whatever you want to call it. And then we've got all of a sudden, you know, food, they're pimping the narrative. Huge food shortages, you know, Cargill shut down. This did this, you know, fake meat. And I'm looking at Soylent Green and I'm like, okay, I'm not to the point where they're going to start hurting the old people and making food out of them. But if you can think about when you look at some of the things in Soylent and they're like, okay, Tuesday is Soylent Green Day. And it's like the day when I know when it's check day here, I don't go shopping because the grocery store is full. So is it going to be that Tuesday is the day you get X and Wednesday is the day you get Y and this? And they've already started corralling us. They've already started the herd mentality. They're already starting to, you know, okay, we're going to line up for food. They're just getting the psyche ready. And that's my opinion. They're using all of the avenues that they're using. They're pulling out all the stops right now. And this is my opinion, of course, about the movies, but it's easy way to deaden the psyche. Very different upbringing. I grew up in East Germany. Corporate stuff has always been over my head. Okay. East Germany. You grew up in East Germany? Did I read that right? Yeah. But there it is, the corporation, right? Even I fall victim to that, you know?
Wow.
Grew up in East. So before the wall fell, I don't know. I don't know. When did the wall fall? The 90s? Gorbachev, tear down that. Was that Reagan? That was Reagan, wasn't it? Mashing my memories. But we look at the food stuff going on.
Fell in 1989. Okay.
Okay, great. And I can segue right into the next movie that was 1989. Yeah. I believe that was the Reagan era, if I'm not mistaken.
89.
Yeah, 89, I was, okay, you were 11. Okay, so you're a little bit younger than I am. But 89, I was 20, well, 863, so. Yeah, I was 25. I was just, yeah, getting ready for my first dive, my major dive course. It changed my whole life. My 1 year, that was the best part of my life. Anyway, so let's talk about the package. The package, Gene Hackman, 1989, Gene Hackman, Dennis France, John Hurd, there's Pam Grier and Joanna Cassidy are in it, but unfortunately in this movie, it's basically male dominated. It's all conspiracy stuff, Cold War, Russia bad, America good, you know, devils inside an organization trying to stir up the shit. And that's what, when I look about false flags, and I see how when we look at our modern history, when we can discuss back and forth about 9/11, about certain things that have happened in our modern history that have caused a conflict or a strife in certain areas, and we look at just in our modern history, like the stuff they'll say about anything so that they can get a conflict going, you know, Iran, whatever, North Korea, you know, this guy did this, so we're going to have to go do this. But when I think of the package, the premise of the package is that the Gene Hackman character, the main character, is escorting a prisoner for trial. And there's shenanigans. He loses his prisoner. And as he's trying to investigate what's going on with this guy, things start unfolding when he uncovers a possible plot to assassinate either the premier or the president of the United States. I'm mixing up. I can't remember who was the target exactly. I think it was the premier because they did the operation in America. So yeah, and it would have been shooting the premier. So it's just more ginning up and more just to get us down the road, another football play just to get the football down the road. And I look at the package and I think about all the false flags and stuff that I believe are false flags and or questionable things that are, you know, in our modern history. And I look at this and the way the movie unfolds about, you know, inner workings, compartmentalization, people who know, people who don't know, people on the inside, people on the outside, pats, dupes. It's a wonderful movie. It's a wonderful movie. It's very action packed. There's a couple of slow spots and I'll give this one a hard 8. You know, it's got the Gene Hackman when he beats the shit out of that government car. It's almost reminiscent of The French Connection, but it's a very good movie, and it's a very good tinfoil hat conspiracy movie, because it all falls in perfectly, right? You know, all the key figures. But then if you look at it and you look at our 9/11 and everything just kind of worked out perfectly and where we are today, you know, of course, in the movie, in the package, the ending is a good ending. Of course, you know, the good guy wins. You know, unfortunately, in our real life, that doesn't always come to pass. So, but I fully encourage you to watch the package in 1989. The package 1989. I noticed that I type in the package and it goes right to the 2012. They've redone a lot of these movies. You know, they'll redo a lot of these movies, and they'll like, well, Rollerball. Look at, I tried to watch the new one. I thought it would be honorable to the old one. It was just hateful, hatefully bad. So you look at, and to me, it's like they redo the movies because they don't want you watching the old ones. Because in my opinion, the old ones are amazing. They do have a message. That's just my opinion. But I did wanted to talk, I do want to talk about, and I'm talking, when we're talking about similarities and parallels, I just wrote down, I have no idea what this show is. It's called Dark Mirror. All I do is I'm reading through the comments and I'm reading through the stuff that people are telling me that there are similarities, like almost verbatim, or things that are happening in the show are happening today, whatever, what have you. Now, I don't know that, I haven't investigated, but it wouldn't surprise me. Because that, and also too, it's a good defense mechanism. Oh, that was in the movies and you believe that to be true? And they can kind of, ha 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 ha, you're so foolish. You believe that, yeah, you believe that, you know, acorn or unicorns exist, ha 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 ha, because you saw it in Blade Runner, ha 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 ha. You know, it's not what it's, well, you know, they can use it for that as well, but good luck with that, because there's more to it. The TV's been around a long time, movies have been around a long time, to put a message forward or to not put a message forward. It's up to you to decide. But just wanted to talk, or to briefly touch on just the two movies that I'd mentioned earlier. Failsafe, Doctor Strangelove, Armageddon, and Deep Impact. Okay. Failsafe and Doctor Strangelove came out in 1964. Same year after I was born, during the Cold War era, we were all going to die from nuclear weapons, you know, drop under your desk, everything like that. I mean, I was a year old, so I don't really remember that, but that's what I was told by my parents, that it was quite frightful. And plus, we had just gotten out of, I believe we were in the McCarthy era years. We were just in that time frame. So there's a lot of fear and paranoia going on during the nuclear age. We'll just call that the nuclear age. And I've seen both movies. And I've read up the write-ups on both movies, the Failsafe. We'll just talk about Failsafe and Dr. Strangelove first, or How I Come to Love the Bomb, or Not Be Afraid. Anyway. Supposedly, according to the write-up, that Stanley Kubrick found out about Failsafe while he was doing his, you know, Dr. Strangelove bit. Now, I can't remember which one came out first. I think I wrote it down. Yeah, Dr. Strangelove came out first and Failsafe came out second. Now, I don't know what was going on and in all the intermixings, but there was some shenanigans about a book and they wanted to halt Failsafe and they wanted to get Strangelove out first. So Strangelove came out first. Now, and you look about Strangelove, like everybody loves Dr. Strangelove. Everybody thinks it's the greatest movie. There's more quotes and snippets from that movie that you take away, you know, from Slim Pickens. Riding the bomb all the way down to certain things that are said during the movie. I mean, I love the guy who comes in. I can't remember the character's name, but his name on his bat guano, or you know, bat something like bat guano, you know, bat shit. So like, you know, bat shit crazy. Like, you know, they were the special forces guys. So things like that were, that movie's been very in the forefront. You look at Failsafe and it's like nary a mention, almost nary a mention. They both came out in the same year, both dealing with subject matter, but one was pimped, one was not. You know, the Kubrick one, fun, rah, 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 Failsafe, you know, there's not a dry eye in the house. It's not a funny movie. It's very dark because it looks at nuclear war it's in the mathematics of it. And it actually goes through the scenario where we're all laughing at the end of Strangelove. You're not laughing at the end of Failsafe. I encourage you to watch both movies. I encourage you to watch them both, like not at the same time, of course, but watch one, watch the other, then watch one and watch the other. Go back and forth, try yourself. But in my opinion, Failsafe is the much better movie cerebrally, because you're thinking during the whole movie. You're like, what would I do? Because you're on the edge of your seat. Dr. Strangelove is a comedy. It's a comedy. It's like comparing Full Metal Jacket to The Boys in Company C. Two Vietnam movies, two almost identical movies, both with Arlie Ermey in it, but completely different movies. Absolutely different movies, you know, with the way it hits you up here. In my opinion, Full Metal Jacket could be considered a dark black comedy in a manner of speaking, whereas The Boys in Company C is not, because it's not a happy ending at all. So, but that's all I can say about that. So when I look at two movies coming out at the same time, especially, and they're trying to put forward something, I'm looking, okay, which one, why is that? What is that? You know, they seem to do movies. You got one and it's like they did like Manhunter. If you look at Manhunter, they've got two identical movies. One, I can't remember the name of the character's name. Then they've got one with Ed Norton. And they're the same movie. And I'm like, why did they redo it and change things, you know? Okay, there's a reason. I may not be smart enough to figure it out, but there's a reason. And I'll just touch quickly on Deep Impact. And you know, I put 12 Monkeys in there for like movies and such. But I was looking at Deep Impact and Armageddon. They both came out in 1998. And these are these two movies again. So we have the nuclear war movie, 1988. I don't know if there was a rock that was going to kill us, and they decided to put a movie out and nothing ever happened. So they just went, oh, great movies. Armageddon, I believe Deep Impact came out first. Armageddon came out later. Deep Impact came out in May 5th. But you know how movies work. So they're always, you know, talking, understanding, knowing what's going on.
What about Greenland trailer being pulled? Yes, we'll talk about that too. We can talk about
that's an interesting one, because I wanted to touch on Swan and Master and all that, but just finish up with Armageddon. And when Deep Impact, they were like, they rushed Armageddon out. According to the write-up, it was 16 weeks to do the whole movie. That's fast when you think about sometimes how long it takes to write a movie, to get the characters, to hire them, to do everything, to get the sets. 16 weeks, you're talking a fever pitch. Now, back then, that was like 30 years ago, right? Or sorry, 20 years ago. So, you know, was something going on back then? Something definitely was going back in 1964 with nuclear war. 1998, who knows? But there again, okay, just I'm going to end on with, because I'll finish talking about the movies, but what I'm trying to put forth is that over our history, over our lifetime, and in my modern lifetime, over my 57 years almost, TV and movies have been used to guide us down a path. Yes, they are there to entertain us as well. They're like, you know, I'm sure The Mask and Ace Ventura, Pet Detective really don't have any messages. But damn, they're funny. But in my opinion, some movies and some television shows are used to guide you, to mold you, to make you think in a certain pattern. These people are bad. These people are good. Don't eat a Mars bar. Eat a Snickers. You know, so it's just kind of stuff like that. So that's all I'm trying to say with the movies that I've watched, because they've influenced my life in the way I think. Star Trek, Star Wars, Days of Condor, stuff like that. So, well, let's talk about Swan or Greenland trailer. Let's talk about Swan, baby. Okay, Greenland trailer. Yeah, from what I gather, they've pulled it from the internet. Now, from what I gather also, there's also other versions. I keep still finding it is what I'm saying. Every day I go and I say, oh, is it the same place where I did? Oh, it's not here. Somebody else has put a link to find it somewhere else. Now, it is interesting that they have pulled the trailer. And I just wrote this down when I was looking at the comment. I was trying to figure out, because I want to see Swan. It's in the, you know, the supposedly Pisces, Aquarius, so we're supposed to be able to see it. But I was looking at the name. And Comet, when we had Comet F5 Master, then we had the other one that broke up, Y4, but we did Comet Atlas Y4. We didn't really give it a name. Then we have Comet F8. This is the latest one, Swan. And I was just thinking about F5 and F8, about those buttons on your computer and what they do. And I was thinking F5. Oh, F5 is a refresh, and F8 is a recovery, or, you know, when your Windows thing. So I'm like, okay, I'm thinking of the trailer. I'm thinking of the movie coming out this summer. I'm thinking of these F5, F8 designations that are given the Comet. And then you look at all the lore, like our ancient lore about, you know, portents and comets being portents in some kind of change in our age or whatever. And you look at all the stuff that's going on right now, the distraction of the word, the distraction the word is caused. So, okay, I am not here advocating that this is it, you know, we're all going to get crashed on, but there again, what is it? You know, why did they pull that trailer? Because I've always seen people say, oh, well, it's because they don't want us to be scared. They want to, you know, think of the children. You know, it's always the same thing. Think of the children. You're just so selfish. You know, so I'm thinking, okay, they wouldn't give a hill. They wouldn't give a rat's ass. Okay, let's be real. They wouldn't give a rat's ass. And they wouldn't tell us to the last minute, you know, but be real. Asteroids come to kill us all or whatever. So you're going to see pandemonium. You are going to see that. Let's be real, right? Look what's going on right now, just over a mask or some toilet paper. Okay. So why did they pull the trailer? Is it so to calm us all down? Was there a copyright something or other? Is it just that simple? Oops, we something in the background, one of the scenes, and we didn't get permission to have that book. So now we've got somebody said, you got to pull that until you pay us $10,000.
Netflix is playing every pandemic movie. They don't care if we are scared.
Yeah, that's the thing. You know, so why did they pull the, you know, it's not to save the children. You know, could it be as simple as a copyright thing? I don't know. Could it be that they want to, you know, really just really get us going, or they pulled it so they get us really even more scared? I mean, these are really, we could have questions all day long, but I'm with you. It seems odd. Why did you pull the trailer? And now you got people talking. The internet's a buzz because they're going to get bored with this virus. Oop, I said the word. Ooh. Oh, I'm screwed. Anyway, I'm just teasing. It is true. Yeah, I was on Netflix the other day. They've got all the fear porn going. You know, I just do my thing with Netflix. It's just something to waste the time. I just wanted to make sure I hit on all bases there this morning. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to Comet Swan. I don't know. I tried to find it. I'm still like, you know, I'm not an astronomer, so I'm having a hard time looking in the sky and, okay, I know I should look in the south and stuff like that, Pisces, Aquarius and stuff like that. I want to see this movie. I want to see this comet disaster movie because I want to see how, if it's any good. Like Armageddon was a good flash movie, like good, you know, visuals, terrible movie, but a good visuals. It's like when you can appreciate a movie for its visuals, the story's terrible. Like 2012, the effects are great and da, 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 da. The movie's terrible, but the effects are good. So that's all I'm saying here. So. But I'm keeping an eye on the deep impact Armageddon type Comet Swan. Who knows what's going to come down? And I'm just looking for the show. But I haven't really, you know, like I figured the internet would be just a wash of people talking doomsday about this comet. But unless it's being scrubbed, or you know, they're just not talking about it, I don't know what to say. I mean, the trajectory would have us believe, according to the JPL, that it's not going to be anywhere close to us. But there again, I'm not an astronomer. You know, I look at the JPL and sometimes I think, oh crap, that should be really close to us. And then I'm like, no, I'm way off. Yeah, it did. Well, I wanted to watch the movie anyway, because I'm like that space guy, like anything space. Well, new Star Trek and new Star Wars ain't doing it because I've been burned. And I don't want to be burned again. But this one is a new movie, so I'm hoping that it'll be something that would be worthwhile watching. you know, like I enjoyed Guardians of the Galaxy. I really thought it was a good movie. The second one was not, in my opinion, not as good as the first. Just like I found T2 was better than the first. Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan was better than the first. But, you know, it is what it is. But yeah, the fact that they did. The fact that they did. Maybe that was just it. It wasn't getting enough traction, or nobody was talking about it because everybody was looking at the word. So they said, well, let's do this. And, you know, I mean, these are all, they've got probably got rooms full of psychologists saying this, do this and they'll do this, do this and they'll do that. You know, so it can't be that hard. So, but anyway, that's it for the show today. Just wanted to talk about movies, how they influence my life in a manner of speaking. You know, to be honest, like when I joined the military back in 1980 something, you know, Stripes was coming out and stuff like that. So it was like, although when I was introduced to the real military, I was like, well, this isn't what Bill Murray was. You can't do that. You can't do what he did on Drill Square and not get into trouble for it. You learn your lesson very funny that sometimes you can emulate that kind of behavior, but in the real world, when you say, yeah, but it was cool in the movies, you know, like the coyote with the stick of dynamite up his ass, it doesn't work in real life. So that's the thing about the movies is you got to take them with a grain of salt. But yeah, that's what I just wanted to touch on today. You know, it's obvious to me, you know, they did it from soap operas, you know, like Days of Our Lives and stuff like that. You know, we got to sell our soap. We got to sell our Costco. We got to sell our fear. We got to sell something. So we got to get there. And this gray matter is easily manipulated, you know, myself included, right? I'm no better than anybody. I'm the same as everybody else. I'm a human being, you know, right in the middle of the pack pretty well, you know? So I'm just trying to figure it out like you guys. And when I see something that possibly could say something to me, I just want to tell it to you guys. And like I said, these are just my opinions, my feelings, and how I see things. But there again, I'm just trying to, because we all want answers, right? We all want answers. And this is what we're doing. We're doing this so we can get answers, you know, or more questions so that we can garner more answers. And that's all there is. So anyway, I hope you like the show. Friday, same time, same bat time, same bat channel. Probably going to get a copyright for that. Anyway, peace to you and yours. Hope to see you on the flip side.